or anti-Mahayana Buddhism, because of the history. They were not actually until the 9th, 10th century. Sri Lanka had Mahayana monasteries and Vajrayana, for example. But then after the 10th century, when the synthesis evaporated in India by then because of the Islamization of India, then Sri Lanka had a new wave where they kicked out Mahayana and Vajrayana, and they got all super orthodox Theravada. And then people don't know that in Japan, Korea, China, although they're Mahayana, they're freaking out about Tantra. And they think Tantra is some terrible thing, you know, like sex and violence, whatever. Yep. And they all like Dalai Lama personally. They all acknowledge that he's an amazing being, but they kind of have these prejudices. Okay. So, Eric, you want to lead off any questions, or shall we redo some mantras, or what should we do?
Sure. Do you guys have any questions?
Anybody have questions? Based on what we've been talking about, either Eric or me? Think for a minute. I have a question. Yes.
I was just wondering in terms of what you talked about this afternoon, and thank you. And you're talking about mathematicians and modern scientific, and how like the materialistic world,
yes,
and trying to find the ultimate reality within a materialistic mind frame.
Right.
I wonder to which extent actually, like it seems that these are very useful tools to understand the reality, right? Like mm-hmm. relative reality.
Uh-huh.
And it's only at a moment where they can't find anything anymore that then the mind can go into ultimate reality. But to which extent do you think that there's going to be a moment where the materialistic mindset might see the possibility of an ultimate reality within the framework that is being created? Because in a sense, to me, it seems that it could be that it's the first step of trying to find real reality.
The materialistic way.
Yeah.
Well, yes and no. Like any good thing, I think yes and no. I think that actually that to go through the mind is more direct. So that's the no. And it's more direct because sort of there's a famous verse of Shantideva's talking about tolerance, you know, patience and tolerance, where he says, if you don't like walking on the earth with all the sharp stones and thorns and different things, because it hurts your foot, you have two choices. One is you can cover the earth with leather, the entire earth, and then walk on suede. I always think of a softball or a baseball or a basketball, planet basketball, you know. Or you can make yourself a pair of sandals, you know, and have like a surface under your foot that protects you from the sharp things. So the analogy of that is, you know, if the mind is well regulated and well understood, the reality of the mind, and you can more manage your mind, then whether the outer world is well regulated or not is not irrelevant, but you can deal with different situations, you know, even if the outer world is not perfectly regulated. So it's more practical to go through the mind. And I think similarly in seeking the nature of reality, the Indians made the decision, like on the basis like of that sandal analogy, that each of us, of the realities that we confront, our internal reality is the most immediate one to us. And therefore, if we can understand through that reality, instead of living in denial of it, then we have, it's like the closest we can get to it. The materialistic one is kind of a huge detour, where we sort of distract ourselves from dealing with ourselves by saying, well, let's understand how the oceans flow and how the stars turn and how the, you know, et cetera, you know, like all kinds of external things. And we, if we can get control of all of those things, then we'll have a really great scene here. You know? Meanwhile, we are emotional basket cases, you know. So no matter how the scene is, it's not, we're not that happy in it, A. And B, a quantitative way of trying to understand reality, of course, is because reality is infinite, will never end. So there's also the basis, you know, there's a basis in materialistic science. There's a basic presupposition that no one can actually understand reality. And even there's the delusion that the material reality is the ultimate reality, and it's just a matter of therefore measuring it, and so they're not looking through it, so to speak, you know, kind of, I would say, you know. And is the fantastic technologies that the West has developed from the Greek root, supposedly, although, for example, decimal system came from India. It did not come from either the Arabs or the Greeks, or the Romans, but from India. Is all this fantastic technology, is it really that useful? That's also another question. I mean, I don't know if you were saying that, but you mentioned something useful. But is it, or is it actually ultimately simply magnifying the imbalances in our minds to this incredible self-destructive degree? For example, the mind has hatred. Like one lama I know, we think of a formula for a nuclear weapon, you know, like of which there are, what, 10,000 of them that could destroy the planet like 500 times over, all ready, triggered if Mr. Putin has a bad digestion or something, or Mr. Bush or some one of these morons. And we would think the formula for that is, you know, you have the trigger mechanism and some plutonium, and then it goes out, and then it ignites the uranium-235, blah, blah, blah. And we think of it as a physical formula that makes it, you know, and then there's some machining of parts and the in containers and things. But a Tibetan Lama once said to me that the key ingredient of the nuclear weapon is hatred in the mind of the inventor, and hatred in the mind of the user, because the trigger mechanism is the hatred in the human mind, for example. So now a normal human mind that is afflicted with hatred and wants to destroy somebody, in the previously they would have to get a sword, train in martial arts, go out and start hacking, you know, and like be a better swordsman than the other one, you know, at least they had to kind of do it with their body. Whereas in this case, mental hatred can be so magnified by that technology that you could destroy hundreds of thousands, or you could destroy the entire planet, actually. Right? All life on Earth can be destroyed by a nuclear winter. That would be the end of this planet, right? It's like it, if they detonated even one-tenth of those weapons. You follow me? So while it's, you, I enjoy driving a car, I have like this and that gadget in the house. They are convenient, but maybe they are a little bit distracting too. I've had a nice time. I remember when we were younger, we were with two of our children and one baby. We were in India in '70. We were in a place with no electricity, no water, no running water. We had to buy water from somebody, or we had to walk ourselves to a well some distance. And, you know, if we did one thing in a day, we felt we'd accomplished a lot. Like read one chapter or something, or, you know, and then had to finish before the sun went down because the candlelight was so irritating to read in. And then we went to bed at a reasonable time, got up at the dawn. Actually, when we got into the rhythm of that, it was very, very pleasant, in fact. And I was very proud of the Dalai Lama, for example, in his book, Ethics for the New Millennium, where he said that which he wrote in 1999, and he said, I used to think that this modern technology, and he's a modern technology bug, all along the side. He used to take watches apart when he was a little kid in Tibet. He got some car that some people had brought the parts over the mountains and was there in Lhasa, the few roads that they were, and tried to fix it up and whatever. And So here's a big takeaway. He said, I used to think that all these developed countries, they were quite marvelous, and that they had lessened, and all this science and technology, material science and technology, had lessened the degree of human suffering, he said. But then he told a story about how he was in a wealthy house in England, and, you know, he was a house guest there at some point, and very nice people, having a nice time visiting them, and he was out giving some teaching somewhere. And then he said he's a natural snoop, which I know is a fact, because he was visiting my house in Amherst, and he came on short notice, so we hadn't had time to really clean, so we threw a lot of stuff in different closets. And then one time, he opened one of those closets as he was walking through between one room to another, as he was getting a tour of the house, and all his stuff all fell out. And he went, oh, I'm tiny. He was having his Indian accent. It was like 81, 84, or something, 84, I think, in Amherst, Massachusetts. Oh, I'm tiny, he was so thrilled, he was excited. Anyway, he was a bit of a snoop, he said, in his house. And then he opened the medicine cabinet in the bathroom, because I guess they gave him the master bedroom or something as a sign of respect to the owners of the house. And he was shocked by all the tranquilizers and the Prozac and all the anxiety, and, you know, antidepressants and like quantities of them in the medicine cabinet. Of these, you know, should be comfortable, happy people, you know. And then finally, he said he decided that the main thing about the modern technology was more fancy houses with lots of cars and a lot of people driving back and forth between them. But that it hadn't, therefore, overall lessened the amount of human suffering. It just shifted the type of human suffering from sort of more physical suffering to more mental suffering and things like that. So he was not any longer glorifying the concept of development, you know, which is. When you come from an underdeveloped country and you deal with all these paternalistic people who are telling you, like, to develop, that he finally cured himself of that. You know, at that, by that time, in 1999, he was born in 1935, so that was 64 years old. Maybe he had this experience maybe in his early, late 50s or something, early 60s, he was referring to. Because he still kind of seemed to accept us, we were a backward country, he would sometimes say. In some ways, they were backward, but for example, the Chinese, since they have colonialized Tibet, they have built a road system in Tibet, and driving trucks and cars and things. But what was the purpose of the road system? They were extracting timber, herbs, borax, minerals, polluting rivers, wrecking the place to extract with their trucks. That's what they wanted, and the railroad train, you know. Then, they have Tibetan slaves maintaining the road system, out there road workers. Then they, for a while, they were pretending they weren't migrating people into a minorities area. So they had, they were saying, they were posting, well, we have a few hundred thousand technicians helping with the development of Tibet, you know, the sort of backward Tibet. And the technicians were from Sichuan, like breaking stones on the road too. Because the Tibetan laborers were, they didn't want to give them the job or whatever. You know. So, and similar, so the Tibetans didn't make a road system. And then I think some of those early British books about Tibet travelers, they didn't use the wheel. They were primitive, you know. Well, they had prayer wheels everywhere. Prayer wheel around. They just didn't use cars, of course, they didn't want to maintain a road system because the work, the people that had to be corvée labor, the farmers who were better off planting their crops than out there slaving on a road system, so somebody could ride in a. They were like Ivan Illich, intermediate technology people, you know, that great Ivan Illich about tools for conviviality, about how there's a questionable thing about a lot of our technology. And the military one, then we have industrial technology, and you can make, you know what I mean, you can have like Barbie made in China and shipped over in a ship, you know, and burn a lot of gas, and they can make it in a factory burning coal-fired power plants. One comes on the line a week, a new one every week. They make you solar panels to sell here in coal-fired power plants, which is wrecking the air in California, not to mention in their own country. So that's the green side, you know, magnified by industrial technology. So what's nice is that finally, now, actually, I think in ancient times, some Christian monastics like St. Francis, St. Bernard of Clairvaux, a lot of Russian Orthodox mystics and people like that, I think they got deeply into mind science. the Desert Fathers in Egypt, you know, earlier times, and you had a kind of knowledge of the mind. Plato, I think, among the Greeks, the Eleusinian mysteries, they were getting stoned on some kind of moving mushroom there, running around, worshiping Athena, and whatever it was, Apollo. And then they were cracked down, library about that great Clytemnestra, you know, what was her name? Not Clytemnestra, the Hypatia, the wonderful woman mathematician in Egypt in the Library of Alexandria in the 3rd, 4th century. There were all kinds of great things going on. And who burned them down? The Christians. Because they don't like the free mind thinking. And then they suppress the mind. So then Westerners got the idea that the inner stuff is all some religious thing. And much better, let's explore nature and read the book of nature. And then we'll find out what God thinks in nature. And get away, and then that led to them, forget about the mind because that's the soul and they're terrorizing us. We're going to go to hell. We got to break away from the church. So then we'll do materialism. But then luckily with materialism, they finally reached quantum things, but they were matter dissolved under their grip in the middle of their cyclotron, you know. Matter is dissolved. So what had they got? Dark energy. Dark energy came up theoretically by a woman physicist in Cambridge, by the way. Yin, you know, yin and yang, light and dark. And she put yang in its place. All those male physicists. 3% of 3% of visible matter, which is only 3%. We got you guys enfolded in 97% that you can't see. I love it. But I don't know. So I would know that that's precisely the romance. You know, I think some literary people write about the Great Exposition of London of 1898 or something, 1897, the Crystal Palace, and the idea that industrial technology was going to make a heaven on earth. 19 years before World War I, it's going to be heaven on earth with industrial technology. So yeah, yes and no, but mostly no. Anyway, it's like, look who's not fixing up the planet today. Freeman Dyson, supposedly great physicist. Oh yeah, because we'll all go live on Mars. So human beings just will wreck wherever they are. We'll go live on Mars. And you know, techno-fix people. Ray Kurzweil. Don't worry about it. We'll all download ourselves into computers. Then your brain will be peeled by an onion by Ray's peeling thing. And then the structure of your personality, which is just some code in the brain, will be transmitted into a computer. Oh, and don't worry. It won't be like dry, horrible robot, like Tin Man type of robots. These will be biological robots with soft skin, et cetera, et cetera. And Walt Disney can be revived, we can peel his brain, and Walt Disney will ride again. He was cryogenically frozen, and he lives in a warehouse in Los Angeles now. These people are wacky. They're completely out there. And they refuse to be responsible for the stream flowing in front of their feet. Right? I think. That's just my opinion. And what is your field? What are you?
I'm in the arts.
You are what?
In the arts.
You're in the arts? Oh, but you're giving those technologies big. What's your leeway?
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
In fact, I have several.
But make a phone call. Okay. Well, although this is your turn. I'm talking too much.
I hope it's my question.
Do you believe that in, you know, in our range of understanding and historical knowledge and whatever, that there was ever less suffering at any time in the history of humanity from now? Meaning, could you conceive of an age that was less materialistic, less driven? And that's the first question. The second question.
Whoops. Do I believe there's any hope? In short, I think I got it.
No, she's saying, was there ever a time in human history where people had less suffering?
And connected with that.
Yes.
You know, I mean, in the West, we are so proud of the mind driving us in inventions and everything.
Yes.
Do you believe that the mind could be induced, of course, I understand a little in Buddhism, induced to transcend, but for the majority, we are all trying to get ahead in our thinking, and science, with the positive and the negative, are a part of human nature. We can't stop it. Or my question is, can we and should we stop it?
Stop what? Sorry.
This drive, this drive with all the negatives that are, you know, part of industrialization.
The drive to overcome the negative and to have the positive.
Yeah. So could we, or do you think it would be preferable for all of us to live not now, but in a previous century, where there wasn't so much destruction going on? You know what?
No.
What should we do?
That's for you. Come on, you say. You live in the mountains of the Himalayan foothills in North India. They're the highest mountains in the British Empire.
I live in some of the last places that still kind of resemble a world before this world. And every day, every year, it's getting less and less far from this world. You know, now in the little village, you know, that it takes us maybe about 45 minutes to get to the nearest kind of town with a paved road. you find mobile SIM card shops. There's at least 5 of them.
Oh, really?
There's maybe 2 vegetable sellers, and there's 5 mobile SIM card shops.
I see.
So it seems like that's what people need on a daily basis in little villages in Garhwal, is
right.
SIM cards.
Well, I like that. Personally, I think there's a combination of high-tech and low-tech will be helpful.
Oh, definitely.
Because one of the terrible things of industrialization on the planet at the moment is everybody's leaving the countryside,
yeah.
All young people. Definitely. They're rushing into city slums everywhere. And nobody's there to work. In Bhutan, even, is totally ruined, becoming totally ruined, this sort of supposed paradise Bhutan, where all the young people have moved into this town and they've built all this unviable thing, and there's no industrial jobs anyway, and they get all, I mean, it's a mess.
Yeah.
And they can't, it's too cold for them, and their houses, the way they were heated, they got central heating in these like slum-like buildings. They're not really slum, but they're not that bad, but they will be, because they're poor and they're bored there, you know. So go back to your first question. Do I ever think there was less human suffering? Yes, I do. And I do think there are societies that are more happy than our society. Because I do think that we actually are more backward than a lot of people have been. We come from this very militaristic European thing. Europe was like a backward part of Eurasia, actually. Where people, and even people make a virtue out of it. Like they act like, oh, it's great that Europe's great because they're always having wars with each other. So that made them make great weapons and then they were able to conquer the planet.
Exactly.
So they make kind of things like that. So I think once you have more violence in a bunch of tribes and things, because the society, the environment is less yielding, then women are suppressed in such societies. And there's a few Valkyries who will beat up the guys, but mostly women are suppressed. And once women are suppressed, everybody's miserable. Children, husbands who are doing the suppressing are miserable, and they become more suppressing. Of course, the women are miserable, being suppressed, and then they take it out in subtle ways on the males who are suppressing them. And then they get more suppressive. So, yes, I do think so. And it's part and parcel of what I think I said, which is that Toynbee himself, Arnold Toynbee, the great scholar, 12-volume study of history, India was California of the ancient world, you know, at least in recorded history. And it was the richest alluvium, several of the richest alluviums, and still is, actually. And the Himalayan loam, the rivers flowing out of the Himalayas, are the most vital as far as replenishing in a floodplain the soils, even today, although they're very polluted now. But they still are. And So therefore, it isn't like Indians were so great, but it was just the best environment, so people could, the kings could be more tolerant of more yogis. You try to be a yogi in Palestine, let's say, or somewhere, or Egypt, except for the pharaoh, and the pharaoh would say, forget it, you got to build some pyramids for me. I get out and work in my field, you know. In China, Confucius completely sneered at the one guy who said he wanted to just meditate and he didn't want to work for the state, you know. And he was like, there was no yogis in Confucius until the Buddhists got there later when China was a little better developed. So I think they were happier in India, actually. From, they'd say, let's say, relatively, nobody was perfect, but they were happier. Another thing I always hold forth as proof is in America, in the 20th century, we had Masters and Johnson. And some people started thinking about what might be an orgasm. And they had and Wilhelm Reich, who had to escape from everybody in Germany and Russia and every place, and then even had to run away from the FDA in Maine here in America. But he was talking about. Whereas they had the Kama Sutra in India like 2,000 years earlier. And Kama Sutra is not just Playboy. It also has how to have a party, how to be nice, don't do this to your wife, maybe you can have a mistress who does that, whatever. Sort of a middle class urban thing because of the wealth of the society. And I'm not saying that was so great and the Buddhists don't really like it. They prefer to sublimate those things. But the point is the culture as a whole had it. And the women at those days were less suppressed, I think, although they didn't get really cure the Brahminical thing completely. But I think it was much more during the classical period, mm-hmm. It was much more open and much more cheerful than it became once the Muslims conquered the place. And once they became, because they became, and the Muslims did conquer them because they were less militaristic, but they were having more fun, they were more peaceful, the women were more flourishing. And they were less suppressed because there was less violence. And then we take, for example, we're told in our militaristic society here by our biogrammarians and our social scientists that man is very aggressive, mighty hunter, and we have this huge Pentagon, this massive military budget, all this wasted stuff. We're told that's really correct because everybody's after us. You know? Meanwhile, the rest of the world is terrified of us, of the U.S. right now. And we have no funds for students are $1.4 trillion in debt. And since Bennett was Secretary of Education, they can't even have a hi-fi in their room or have a party. They're no longer allowed to have any fun. And I've noticed it since I've been teaching. You know, so. So yes, and we're told yes that nobody ever demilitarized voluntarily. And in a way, of course, the ones that did are a counterexample. The Mongolians, Genghis Khan, people, the largest empire in world history, they completely demilitarized. The Tibetans completely demilitarized. They were low-tech and cheerful, quite cheerful, and quite happy. Chinese propaganda is a bunch of baloney, feudal system, and that's just crap. They were not a feudal system when China conquered them. That if they were a feudal system, they would have had nobles with armies, they would have fought back. And Chinese army would have had difficulty at that altitude with people who were fighters. They were not at all a feudal system, they were a peaceful place. And they had been a conquest empire 1,000 years earlier, but they had demilitarized and they were much happier. That's why people like these colorful paintings, they make their mandalas, these monks fooling around. They're happier, they're cheerful people. Actually, still, they have a great record of non-suicide in exile, actually, compared to others. They won some UN prizes before China took over the UN, and the UN couldn't even mention Tibet because of the world's collusion and the Chinese genocide of the Tibetans. Now, of course, the counterexample is because they weren't armed to the teeth anymore. They were eventually trashed by the Chinese, the Russians, the British, you know, by the world imperialist people. But at the same moment as the Tibetans have been trashed, they're all over the planet. And they're really beloved, actually, by the people on the planet, pretty much. Except some Chinese propaganda swallowing people. So, and even the Chinese people love them, actually. There are a lot of Communist Party officials sneak over in Shanghai and learn to meditate from some Tibetan Lama. In fact, Taiwan, they're hugely, when the Dalai Lama went to Taiwan, it wasn't like the Pope coming, it was like Jesus coming. more intense than the Pope, because he's going in for them, you see. So yes, there have been happier people than us, definitely. And yes, there are people who voluntarily demilitarized and lived in a vulnerable way, because if you live a little vulnerable, you're actually happier. And you might get killed, but actually you'll still be happier. That was in my Why the Dalai Lama Matters book, which probably, I don't know, not that many people read, but I was asked by the publisher to put 10 points of hope, and my last point of hope was that happiness is the only solution to the world crisis right now. And we have to be happy. Are you happy yourself?
No.
No, see? But you have a duty to be happy. My last slogan in that book was, it is our duty to be so happy that even if they kill us, we will die happy. And that's a great way to end the talk and to prevent people from doing a standing ovation. Because they start to go, yay, and then they go, oh, no way, I'm not doing that. They do that. But what else? Terror, war on terror, it's an infinite war. It was proclaimed by this anti-alcoholic, weird, born again, weirdo, cocaine head, who told us that. Endless, it's going to be endless. So what is that? Endless Pentagon? Is that anybody going to be happy there? With 2 million people in prison, more than any other country on the planet? And more tactical nukes and more money to Rockwell and Boeing and Grumman. And is that really going to work? Is it? You think so? I don't think so. So what makes you happy? You are sometimes happy. Look at you're smiling now. But what makes you happy when you are happy?
This is a philosophical conversation. If I
can I ask you that question? Yes or no?
Well, then
what is it that makes you happy?
I would say happiness is irrelevant.
You think happiness is irrelevant?
I think we are here, we have jobs, we have obligations. If we get to work up love and compassion, yes. And if the
without happiness, compassion is totally meaningless.
Well,
but meaningless.
If
without happiness, compassion is fake.
I know nothing, but I would like to say.
If you know nothing,
no.
Then think about that.
With you, or I'm not arguing. I'm just presenting my point of view, which says that maybe happiness might become a byproduct of understanding that I am really compassionate. And then maybe I will be a little happy and a little satisfied.
Okay. That I see that you have this. So you like what you're interested in. You think Buddhism's main point is that everything is suffering. You got
no,
it that way. You think Buddha's so great because he's like, you know, you're here and interested in Buddhism because you think Buddha really got it right that he said, it's all suffering. That's the tenor of your conversation anyway. It seems like that. Then compassion is really great because we're ready to wallow in that suffering. But don't you understand, compassion means, true compassion means relieving suffering.
Yeah.
If there's no happiness, there's no relieving suffering. So what is the compassion? What is it? It's nonsense. There is a false compassion, Buddhism says, amongst its different kinds of compassion, called sentimental compassion. Compassion that has a concept of the poor thing. It's like Nietzsche's notion of sympathy, which he despises. It's like, in a way, confirming someone in their suffering, because it's based on the person themselves not really feeling that good. So assuming that everybody just not going to feel good, but somehow you should be, someone's worse off, seems to be worse off than you feel at that moment. Well, you should be sorry for them. But why it's considered false is that that kind of view of the person will not result in any effective way of alleviating that suffering. Because in a way, the perception of the compassion, so-called compassionate one under that view is imprisoning them in their suffering by assuming that that's their inevitable state, actually. So therefore, there's no real way of helping them. Whereas, if you have bubbling up in yourself, some awareness of what your actual health is in your body from the Buddhist medical point of view. It is a kind of well-being and happiness in the cells of your body when your brain that is determined that it's all suffering is not interfering with them. Mm-hmm. It's that happiness that you have when you're sound asleep and your mind is not interfering with your sort of cells smoothing themselves out and getting energy from the clear light of the void, we would call it. So other people might say from the loving energy of the universe, whatever they would say, the bounteous energy of the universe. So the first real compassion is only paired with the wisdom of impermanence, they say. Wisdom of impermanence means not trapping anything you see into having to rigidly be what it is, realizing that it's always changing. And when you have that wisdom, you yourself feel better, actually, automatically. Things kind of melt. When you have a bad feeling, it kind of melts away when you have wisdom of impermanence. Then second, that is wisdom of personal selflessness, they call it, which is the beginning of opening toward emptiness. And you only can open to emptiness through kind of becoming in touch with your natural bliss that you have as human being. Human being is a very bliss. What is your brain for? You know that, you know what neuroscientists tend to say? Brain is 90% redundant. You only need 8% of it. And the rest is unused. What is all that stuff doing there? All those things. They can't. And you know another thing? But I think it's really fun. Women's brains are more redundant than men's. That's what these morons say. Because maybe women are more sensitive, actually. The brain is there to feel pleasure, actually. It's what the brain does well. It really does when it's open. It feels good. And it's all through the body, actually. And when you feel a little of that, then you immediately perceive other beings who are more shut down inside themselves, who have what Wilhelm Reich called the emotional plague, where they're afraid of their own inner streaming, as he would call it, their own inner orgone energy, their natural energy. And they feel frightened by it because they feel like they're melting or losing control. They're so scared of everything that they don't want to feel any loss of control. And then when they're like that, when they begin to feel that, then they immediately perceive the other person who doesn't feel that. And it immediately wants to extend to the other person. And that's real compassion. And then the highest compassion is, they say, compassion that doesn't see any suffering being. The non-perceiving great compassion, it's called. Universal compassion. And why is it called non-perceiving? Because it is a compassion that comes from being so open that you actually feel the state of the other being. And whenever they don't feel well, you completely empathize with that. And you want to do something about it as a natural reflex. It isn't a thought thing, in other words. So those are considered the genuine compassions, and they only go along with the type of inner insight that opens a person to feeling their own natural positive energy. I think you like that.
Positive energy, I'm totally in agreement.
Oh, good. Then look at that. Now you're happy.
But I would not call it happiness. So maybe
what?
I'm only arguing.
Well, you know, how do you define happiness? Of course, ordinary happiness, which is dependent upon some external circumstance, in Buddhism is called the suffering of change, because it doesn't last. But wisdom happiness, coming from feeling the reality of things, that is not dependent on external circumstances. That is a natural, that's natural to the two beings, and the human form is adapted to be more aware of that than other animals. Why do we have this soft skin? It isn't a nice, good rhinoceros armor that would then, if somebody comes and slaps us, we wouldn't even feel it, because we have rhinoceros armor. Why do we have a soft skin like that? What's the point of having soft hands? What's the point of that? How about a caress? How about feeling something pleasant? What would a rhinoceros feel? What would a rhinoceros caress feel like? I used to say chalk on a blackboard.
Sure.
Might be good. I don't think so.
No, but I'm saying if I were a rhinoceros.
Oh, good. What?
If I were a rhinoceros, I probably would have sensitivities that respond to another rhinoceros.
If she was a rhinoceros, she would have a sensitivity of pleasure with other rhinoceri.
So that's
well, I have never seen the film about the rhinoceros mating, but I've seen the elephant one. And it's no fun. Believe me, there's no foreplay. There's no lingering. And actually, especially the female is desperate to get away, even being in heat. And they knock over trees. And the guy, that's the worst, from a guy's point of view, has a big hard on running after the female. It's like a log. He steps on it himself, running after it. And somehow doesn't notice, it's so like wound up. Finally catches her, and hers like, oh, the back. And it's no fun. It really is a problem. And then never mind, then there's fish and things, and they don't even get any contact. They just drop some eggs, and then they spew some stuff. And what is that? Come on. Anyway. Come on. What are we saying? So anyway, happiness. So this inner bliss. Bliss, talk about bliss, yes.
What? Just to change the subject for a second.
Change the subject. All right, get a microphone. Have a microphone. Please ask him a question. I'm talking too much.
Universal compassion, but you were just speaking of universal compassion. I go on the Dalai Lama's webpage and I look at his schedule at times, and I'm 65, and traveling up here, Satchel Paige used to call himself old aches and pains. Traveling up here, I feel like old aches and pains. And I look at the Dalai Lama at age 80, flying around the world and teaching people in all these different countries. So when you speak of universal compassion, I say to myself, what drives this individual? What drives the Dalai Lama at 80 years of age to do what he does? So could you comment on his universal compassion?
Well, he is driven, as far as I've seen, he's driven by his own bliss energy, which makes him equally okay when he's sitting at home. He kind of prefers to sit at home. He used to have a rigid rule of 2 weeks at home and then 2 weeks on the road. And a lot of that on the road was in India to his own Tibetan community. And since he retired, actually, from being politically responsible for the government in exile about now 4 years ago, his travel schedule has intensified, actually. And I think what is driving that is his compassion for the people of Tibet, who are reached such a state that over 150 have immolated themselves as a way of trying to call the world's attention to what they consider to be their misery. And you know, on a more relative level of misery. Actually, one thing that is very interesting, to me it's encapsulated in a momentary experience like a mental photograph that I have in my mind. I didn't really take a physical photograph because I always break my camera or something, and I didn't have a cell phone with me. But one time I was in Lhasa when I was still getting visas to Tibet, to China, and around 2006, and there was a guy who'd come bowing every three steps, in full prostration in the dust, with very few teeth, who was, I'd say, in his 60s or 50s or 60s. Very energetic though and healthy, but slim, not too well, not that well fed, but strong, who was in the dust in what's called the Barkhor, which is the circumambulatory street around the Jokhang, the central temple in Lhasa that is like a pilgrimage place for Tibetans. And he was going around there and all dusty, been bowing in the street, he would take three steps and then bow, fall out, facing the ground. And he was sort of sitting up in between. And there were three Chinese police types looking with loathing and contempt and a little bit fear toward him, who were well-fed, well-dressed, weapons, baton, you know, cattle prod, whatever, stick, staring at him like this. And I was like here, it was like a frame like that. And there were three of them, these three very wretched-looking faces, looking very sort of hostile and angry at this guy. And he was sort of in the in a sort of posture of like a partial semi getting up from his bow and ready to do the next one. And he had a grin on his face, what we would call in English, you know, a shit-eating grin on his face of sheer joy. And yet he was dressed in tatters. He was, obviously, he had no baggage. He obviously was ate whatever alms the other Tibetans would give him, some little something. And he had bowed for 1,000 miles through the dust across the plateau and was at near his pilgrimage place and was totally, the inner energy in his being was huge. You know, the inner flow of energy and the satisfaction in his face was enormous. And of course he would, if you asked him, was he enjoying the communist patrols that probably prodded him here and there as he was coming across the street doing this crazy useless thing as far as they were concerned. And perhaps they were fearing he was protesting them by doing it or whatever, you know, their attitude was. He might have said something critical, but he was Mr. Happy, happy as a bee. And they were miserable totally, and yet totally dominant. And yet victims of the what Reich would call the emotional plague, 100%. So when they reach the point where even under oppression, they are not happy, just crawling on the ground, because of the way the way the whole world comes together for them, still, in spite of what's happening, where they then will offer their body in flames, it means that they are disapproving rather strongly of what's going on at the moment. They really are disapproving. And I think he's very driven by that. He's immolating himself, if you will, by teaching and traveling, and he's not really invited anymore to discuss any politics anywhere. They're all embarrassed when he goes to a country. China runs in and tries to stop the visa. Nobody tries this. Bishop Tutu shouts and sued the South African government and proved that they had no right to deny a visa back at Tutu's 80th birthday, but then they're still denying it anyway, even though they lost the suit in the South African Supreme Court. So they deny it again the next time anyway. Because business, money, China, the corrupt elite wants the business money, China. Meanwhile, all you get for being nice with China is you get a handsome trade deficit. And you lose some jobs. That's all you get. It's a complete scam, actually, the whole thing. It's the tolerance of the last potential, you know, evil empire on the planet at the moment, run by this fascist pseudo-communist. But everyone is hypnotized by it. I don't know why.
In the late 60s, or actually early 60s, when Vietnamese monks self-immolated, the world was shocked.
Yeah.
So I remember being a 13, 14-year-old and seeing it on TV, and that stimulated people questioning the Vietnam War. It was the beginning of the protests.
Yeah.
So when the immolation started in Tibet, I was perplexed as to why the national media had not picked up these stories. And they really still haven't.
Who owns the national media? Don't you realize that America has been, because of our corruption, has been colonialized? Do you know what colonialism, how it operates? They go and enrich an elite that in a way depends upon them. The colonial power. And that elite then helps the colonial power strip the wealth out of the nation. Right? So we have an elite that has 535 congresspeople who work for the elite, not for the people that they represent. They're donors they work for. And they pass all these things about, you know, they still have things like no tax for any product made by a job that you pay 20 cents a day, or $2 or $5 a day maybe by now, instead of paying $30 or $20 an hour here. Oh, it isn't the salaries that we're not over there for salaries. There's too much red tape in America. You hear these guys say things like that. These CEOs, you know. The CEOs are huge, and the owners, and the workers are all crushed in this country. You know, that's and of course, they used to export it back here so that people could buy it. And then they hawked their houses to buy it, and then their houses collapsed, and now they can't buy it, so they're all worried what to do. And it's kind of a question. I believe there are still, I was very, very unhappy, I heard from a person who goes, there's still over $750 trillion of bad debt floating and sloshing around the world economy. You know, those CDOs and CDSs and whatever it is, of which certain bankers got huge commissions on. Imagine even 0.5% of $750 trillion, how much money that is. 0.5%. But I don't know what they're committing, probably 3%. So anyway, this is all going to change, I think, soon. But when is, I don't know. And the Dalai Lama is driven by never giving up. He wants people to not give up, not to presume that it will all go wrong, to realize that we can deal with it. And he's dealing with it. And he once looked, I remember there was a certain American Dharma teacher who was in a quote-unquote teacher's conference at the Dalai Lama's place in Dharamsala, some years back, before the current level or whatever it is, who said to his Holiness, Your Holiness, what do you do about burnout? When you teach too much and then you get all freaked out and burned out. And this Holiness said, if you don't find helping others energizing, you're not doing it. In other words, if you find it burning out, maybe you're not really helping them. Well, you know, you wouldn't burn out. If you're helping others, you won't burn out, I think. So I think that's what's driving him. And he's, you know, he's resigned to whatever it is. The change will come when it will come. He has was very much thought in the beginning of the 80s, when Deng Xiao, after the Gang of Four was, Mao died, Zhou Enlai died, the Gang of Four went down in 79. In the early 80s, they thought, you know, Deng Xiaoping invited Tibetan delegations back to Tibet, invited Dalai Lama to come back, but then rescinded that invitation very shortly when he discovered that he'd been lied to by the communist officials in Tibet. They were so deluded that they thought they'd helped Tibet, some of them, that they were telling the Tibetans, don't spit on the Dalai Lama's delegations, you know, because he's from capitalist, you know, back where the CIA plot took him out of Tibet and blah, 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 you know. And so don't spit on them, because now that we've liberated you and you're also happy. And then when the delegation went there, the people like were weeping and tearing their hair and talking about their relatives who've been slaughtered and killed and thought reform and class struggle and unbearable poverty and just awful treatment they'd received throughout the whole thing, not just Cultural Revolution. Total genocidal treatment in the 50s as well as the 60s and the Cultural Revolution. And they were treating the Dalai Lama's representatives like, you know, like emissaries from God, and they were just howling about how awful it had been and save us, that thing. And then he was embarrassed, and then he rescinded that invitation to the Dalai Lama. Then again, when he died, they thought, well, Jiang Zemin, they'll be more practical. The Chinese will. And that when the American Congress made resolutions and presidents. And then they thought so, but no, then the Congress people went and removed human rights considerations from most favored nation so the Chinese could get away with beating up anybody in their own country or any of their colonies and still get preferential trade things here, forget human rights, business of America's business, you know, our creeped out Congress behaving like that. So, you know, he's been disappointed again and again and again. And he's cool, and he remains internally with that inner bliss, and that gives him the health and the energy to go. And actually, he's committed to 103 if necessary. I trapped him into that, but he did. And then he ordered me 97, which is because I'm 6 years younger. And then he got even more revenge the next day because he said, you know, he said, I had a dream last night that I could make 113. So you might, you better take care of yourself. You might have to last 107. He said. So, you know, thank goodness he's still functioning. You know? Yes. And the Tibetans are very worried about it. They kind of try to get rid of invitations and they dump it. You go ask them to go here and there and they say, no, no, no. They don't even give them the letter. And they're trying to do that, but he still goes, you know. Still does. And it's wonderful. I was at like 7 or 8 birthday parties here in the U.S. in early July, 80th birthday parties. And I really enjoyed it. It was really fun. One of the great ones you can see on YouTube, actually, where he, or somewhere, if you Google, is it Michael Franti? Because people know music, Michael Franti?
Yeah.
There's this clip of a short dialogue between the Dalai Lama and Michael Franti that happened in Anaheim at one of the birthday parties, where Michael Franti played something and the Dalai Lama saw everybody hopping around the room and he kind of liked it. And then he had this amazing conversation with Michael Franti. Marvelous. It was really wonderful. Did you see that clip? You were nodding your head at that conversation?
Yeah, check out.
I think that lady in the back saw that.
We'll post it on Bob's Facebook page. Yeah, we did post it on his birthday. We'll post it again.
Oh, good. Please post it. Okay, what time is it?
Pagyab's here making tormas.
Oh, yes. So our Lama is here. Tomorrow morning, 9:30, we start, supposedly. Might be Lama time, but we'll try to start at 9:30. I'll be back in the morning. And we might start it on the different blessings and things.
Can you do the Menla dream yoga really briefly? Go over the instructions again for the Menla dream?
I will. Oh yeah. Well, maybe we should. But can you tell me what time it is?
8:36.
What?
8:36.
Oh, we're fine. We have plenty of time. Yeah. Let's do some medicine Buddha mantras together. I'm talking the whole time. That's terrible. what do you want to share with us?
Well, you know, just from hearing this entire dialogue tonight, the one thing I think that struck me was, you know, you spoke so much about this inner science and how in conflict that is with our current outer science. And
well, I mean, the dogma of it, yeah.
Yeah, and I feel like I'm here representing the outer sciences. So, and maybe the one thing unique about the old outer sciences, yeah, I'd say the Buddhist outer sciences or the, you know, classical Asian outer sciences,
yeah,
is that they knew the place of the inner sciences.
Uh-huh.
And the outer sciences always built themselves where the foundation was the inner science.
Right.
Which is completely different than, because it seems like your main critique of the materialistic science is that they're based on a foundation of this illusory materialism. So perhaps
I do think that they are now discovering the possibility of being complemented in their momentary term by that inner science.
Yeah, exactly.
And I think this is where we can help them not have to reinvent the wheel. That's the dream, isn't that? I don't presume an endless conflict.
Yeah,
but
definitely.
When they become super dogmatic, then they are conflictual because they won't pay attention to it.
Yeah, sure. And I think an interesting thing then is, what is the role of these original outer sciences that did have a concept or you know, were built upon a foundation of understanding the nature of what it is to be? You know, you kept saying how, you know, our human nature of our body is to be in a state of bliss, that every atom, every cell is a pure perfect manifestation of that, and that is the foundation of real health.
Yes.
So Sowa Rigpa is built on that foundation.
Yeah.
So I think what will be interesting as our modern science develops is how the revelations of the old outer sciences will be also maybe rediscovered or will influence the new outer sciences.
Right. Perfect. I totally agree with you. And thank you for adding that. Now, the Dalai Lama, for example, he has been in dialogue with scientists for 25 years, which actually, I started in 1984 at Amherst College. But then they made a separate institution and then he went on with it. But during that time, I was frustrated by the fact that the outer scientists who he was in dialogue with, they considered dialogue to be him listening to them about the great stuff they've discovered. And he goes along with that and he appreciates it. He rarely expresses criticism to them or tries to get them to see it from another perspective. So, and in that situation, I'm constrained in that same way, personally, myself. But on the other hand, what I do, like here or in other places, and I think maybe more and more as I retire from classroom teaching at my university, research university, and as I sort of work on the kind of research level more, I think my goal is to get those outer scientists and those of us who have the outer science thing in our mind, even when we're artists, because when we went to school as little kids, we were in these classes where these very authoritative, you know, physics and biology teachers were forcing us to cut up a frog or something. Some people had. I actually avoided that kind of class somehow. I avoided the frogs, but in high school, people have to do that, right? They have to, like, do some biology class. And so we get to think that that forms our reality sense, our consensual reality sense. It's formed there, not in our churches, synagogues and things, but in those places. And so I want people, especially people who may be interested or who may need, you know, different dietary information, different herbal medical information, different placebo effect, that is to say, mental attitude about illness information, and ability to resist what I consider some of the negative aspects of the industrial medicine. So I want to be more challenged.
Yeah, great.
But I do so out of the idea that I think those folks can be nudged a little more forcefully than just listened to.
Yeah, and, sure.
And I think his holiness does too, but I think he's an outsider. He is a Tibetan. He's from a backward thing. Mm-hmm. They see him as a monk even, which for someone growing up in a Protestant society, they think like, what's his problem? Where's his family? Like, where's his girlfriend? You know, I mean, subliminally, they have that attitude. You know, Protestant-minded people have a weird attitude about monks, for example. Mm-hmm. They're like worried that maybe they're pedophiles or something. They do. Subconsciously, it's there in our attitude. So I'm more challenging. I'm annoying. That's my complimentary thing. Because how can you be responsible for your own health? How can you really decide to put your effort into taking care of yourself without relying uncritically? Of course, you have to rely on resources that are in the society, but without relying uncritically on those sources. And I myself am the same. Like, my wife is way ahead of me. When some doctor tells her or some dentist tells her something, she says, well, why? Well, what? She doesn't listen to it necessarily. I tend to, when I get in the office, I'm like, I go back to where I had my tonsillitis and I was a little boy and they rip me up my tonsils. And I get like, oh, that's authority. Remember they used to have those mirrors they would wear on their head? Like some kind of spaceman. They had a white coat. And they'd be coming in a distinguished looking glasses, looking very serious. They're gonna take this and that out. They're gonna fix it. Okay, let's do some mantras. I think medicine put up mantras. You got to go on. Okay, ready? Now, no gold bricking. I'm watching everybody's lips.
Okay.
You have a request to do it Tibetan style.
What?
You have a request to do it Tibetan pronunciation.
Who does? Well, you're doing your own pronunciation. I'm doing my pronunciation. You can do yours. You don't have to be exactly the same. We're just keeping the same pace, okay? Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja. Okay, ready? We'll go slow first. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Ja Samudhyate Swaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhyate Swaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhyate Swaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhyate Swaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhyate Swaha. Om Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Maha Bhai Shaja Bhai Shaja Raja Samudhyate Swaha. Om Vaishnava Vaishnava Mahavaishnava Vaishnava Raja Samudyate Swaha. Om Vaishnava Vaishnava Mahavaishnava Vaishnava Raja Samudyate Swaha. Om
Om Vaishnava Vaishnava Mahavaishnava Vaishnava Raja Samudyate Swaha. Thank you.
We've been 300 tonight. Very good. Now, I was just thinking, as my mind was wandering between the last 100, that I do have a friend who had was diagnosed with a kind of cancer. Not a really terribly immediately life-threatening one, but dangerous one. And in his early time of studying Tibetan, Indo-Tibetan Buddhism, he had one geshe from Ladakh who helped him recite a lot of medicine Buddha mantras and do a lot of prostrations to the eight medicine Buddhas. Yeah. And then they diagnosed it as having remitted by itself. Yeah. And he sort of, from a very personally, you know, rigorous, philosophical, rational, scientific thing, he kind of got it to where he decided he would try to put his full placebo effect, his mind, his faith in that, and it worked in his case.
Wonderful.
Really? Cool. I was thinking about that. I was thinking that I myself, if I was so diagnosed, maybe I would not be able to. Sort of came in my mind. Then I was redoubling my Vaikhandi, Vaikhandi, Mahavaikhandi. And by the way, if you say that very slowly, like a flowing water, Vaikhandi, Vaikhandi, Mahavaikhandi, Vaikhandi, whether it's ha or sha, it becomes less relevant after you're going quickly like that. It's sort of wherever the palatal sound, sha sound. What it is a retroflex sh, meaning a sha, with the tongue rolled, in a retroflex. You know the Peter Sellers thing when he imitates the Indian accent, I'm going down to down.
Yeah.
They have that called retroflex T, where your tongue is curled like saying an R, and then you make a dental sound like da, 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 da. Like that, so there's a combination, it's like a DR, you're ready like a DR. So this is a sh with an R sound, and the tongue drum like sh, like that. But it's a very fluid and mellifluous sh, 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 you know, sound. And about the Tibetan thing, I want to say there's a story I want to tell. It's told about the fifth Dalai Lama. And the fifth Dalai Lama had a spyglass, and he used to look at people out in the street, in the roads. There was no buildings around the Potala in those days, so he would look over into Lhasa. And he saw one lady with his spyglass who was going around with an elderly woman repeating some mantra, apparently, was counting her rosary. And he saw above her head, like a tara, a green tara was sitting above her head, going around with her, like floating around one tara, goddess, obviously blessing her. So he sent someone out to find her and bring her up to his office or whatever his audience room, and he said, well, what are you doing? How come you're so blessed to have the Mother Tara there? Like, that's really wonderful. And how is that? And she said, he says, how, what are you reciting? And she said, I'm reciting Om Tari Turi Swaha. And he said, oh, that's nice. Okay, well, keep it up, you know. And then she was leaving. And then as she left, the Dalai Lama's chamberlain, you know, his like major domo sort of character, butler, he said to her, oh, miss, I couldn't, madam, I couldn't help overhearing that you're reciting Om Tari Turi Swaha. But the correct Tara mantra is Om Tari Tutari Turi Swaha. So really you should say that Om Tari Tutari Turi Swaha. She said, okay, yes, sir, sure, I'll do that. So then the next day, she was out there circumambulating and reciting, and the Dalai Lama was looking at his spyglass, and then he didn't see Tara up over her head. There was no tara over it. So he sent them back out to call her back in. And she came back up and he said, well, what happened? There's no tara with you now. And she said, well, your chamberlain told me the correct pronunciation was Om Tari Tutari Turi Swaha. And I've been trying to say that, but somehow, maybe, I don't know why she's not up there. And I said, well, go back to your old one, the incorrect one. Obviously, your faith is connected with that. So say that. So then the third day, then she would say, then again, Tara was there, and she was going, Om Tari Turi Swaha. So that's a case where it's not actually the Tibetan correct pronunciation. It's just whatever she thought was good. Mm-hmm. But it's not correct. Tari Turi Swaha is wrong. But it's what she thought was good. So let's just do what we think is good. That's the best. Use your own critical reflection and don't just slavishly follow what people tell you. Okay? So now you asked me about the meditation thing about sleeping. So that has to do with the Book of the Dead, which we'll discuss more thoroughly on Saturday. But remember, by now I'm sure you did research and memorized the 8 stages of dissolution, right? Who wants to recite them for us? Anybody from last night or from your research? Earth into water. And the sign, the inner sign, the inner experience of the person who is either dying or falling asleep is mirage or like hallucination. Water into fire, and the inner sign, because the eyes are no longer seeing things clearly, the senses are not functioning clearly, is smoky, like one is in a space of smoke. Then fire into wind, and the inner sign are fireflies or sparks. Or actually another one that's quite good is moiré patterns of pebbles falling in, or raindrops falling on the surface of a pond, where you have the moiré patterns of the ripples, or fireflies or sparks or moiré patterns. And then wind into space or consciousness, either one, two ways. And the sign there is a single, very still candle flame. Sort of just at the moment before it gutters out, and it's very, very still. Still candle flame, it's the inner sign. Then consciousness, or space, into luminance. And the inner sign is a moonlit sky, autumn's cloudless autumn sky, lit by moonlight. Luminance. And then luminance into radiance. And radiance is a clear autumn cloudless sky illuminated by orange-reddish sunlight. And then radiance into immanence, which is, and the inner sign of that is brilliant darkness. A blackness so black it's bright black. And the opposite of bright, but it's brilliantly opposite of bright. And that's immanence. And then finally you lose consciousness in that state, you let go of your consciousness as you're sleeping, and when you die, you lose your individuated consciousness. And then it's dark light or immanence into clear light, which is the inner sign of which is pre-dawn grayish twilight. A kind of transparency that glitters like a diamond, but yet is beyond the duality of light and dark. So it's kind of a bright gray, something like that, a vibrant gray. And that's where there's this infinite plenum of bliss energy, to which you bring the bliss to it in a way, but it is energy, it's just infinite fulfilling energy. And you imagine that your cells and your body and even your brain and every aspect of you is open to that fulfilling, nourishing, replenishing energy as you sleep.
Bob?
Okay.
Bob.
Yes.